So recently, a friend of mine posted a screenshot of some Java code on Twitter and rambled a little bit about how badly it is readable. And I'm a professional Java developer, so I took a look at it, and yeah, he's right, it is not really readable. But he blamed that on the language being Java and Java being what it is, making it badly readable. And from my experience, that's not usually true, because Java may have some bad defaults, or the defaults that people use are maybe not optimal, but one can certainly structure Java code to be really good readable code. And just by taking a look at the screenshot that he gave, I immediately saw some things that I would certainly ask one of my colleagues to refactor if that was code in our in a pull request in our product. So I thought, well, let's give that a try and see if we can refactor the code to be more readable and more suitable to what I would call clean code. So first, let's take a look at what he actually posted. So that's the code that he posted. And yeah, that's a lot of text and it's a lot of repetition, just judging from the eye. And it's really hard to really see what is happening here. What are these things doing? And it looks like kind of repetitive. So after some Googling, I found that that is probably taken from here. And this is, I don't know exactly if it is example code or if it is actually production code of something that's called a Hawkbit, which is some kind of embedded system over the air network update server thing. I don't know the details and they don't matter for what we have to, for what we talk about today. So, the thing that I want to say is that I don't know who is to blame for the code structure. Maybe they just copy and pasted from the upstream example, or maybe they just looked at the example configuration and tried to figure out what they are doing. So I don't think that my friend or one of his coworkers is to blame for the code that we are now looking at. But starting from here, I created an example project, which basically holds the same code plus the pieces that were missing from his screenshot, but nothing more. The class where that is taken from is a lot longer, so it is like 800 lines, which in itself is quite a problem. But we only have about 100 lines, and most of the code that is not in this configure method is actually boilerplate that is just there to help us refactor the code later. The reason why this file is so big is partially because it is structured like most Spring security configurations are, with inner classes and ordered stuff, and it's I don't like that style. And you can do that in a different way, that they don't need to be inner classes. I don't like that style, and we don't use that in our applications. But for what I'm about to talk, that doesn't matter anyway. So let's focus on that code for a minute. Let's start at the top and skip the imports because they don't matter at all. And usually you don't look at them at all, and your IDE is abstracting them away. So the first thing that I don't like is the way the string constant array is formatted. These are five constants in a string array, and they are equally important. But one of them is formatted in the end here, and one of them is wrapped into two lines because it probably was too long. But I don't like that. I would rather have them be symmetric to each other, and that gives kind of a table-like feeling. If you look at that, the eye can easily abstract away this piece, which doesn't matter at all, and focus on this piece, and get an overview about these strings that are that are used here for the URL matches. If it wouldn't be possible to format it like that, then I would probably try to build this list in a different way. For example, by using a specific builder which prefixes a builder class which does the prefixing for me. Because it is important for the human to see these strings one underneath each other and get a glimpse about how many there are and that these are equally important. So just take that out of the picture. I'm happy with that now the way it is. So now let's focus onto the main configure class. So we are in a class that's named Controller Security Configuration Adapter, which is a hell of a class name. I wouldn't name it like that because that's probably what it does, but it doesn't really explain a lot to me. So what does it do? It configures HTTP security for controller security. Maybe rename it and call it controller security configuration. That's probably enough. What does the word adapter add to that? I don't think it adds anything. So go ahead and rename the class. And that's now short enough, and it doesn't have the extra word that I always have to think about what it actually means. So let's take that out of the picture. Now we know we talk about controller security configuration. And then it's okay to have a configure method here. And it takes security, HTTP security of some kind as input. That's okay, judging from the class and the method name. So let's take a look. What is actually happening here? Here is a controller tenant aware authentication detail source. That is a hell of a class name. And the author already has gone ahead and shortened the variable name. That's half of the thing to not have the variable name the same as the class name because the class is actually already telling the story. But maybe we can shorten the class name too later. For that to check, let's see what we actually implement here. We implement authentication detail source, which it is a typed class, so copying that would make it even longer, so that wouldn't work. So probably this is the shortest class name that we can use. Sometimes we can use a more generic class name here, and we will see that when we refactor the remaining bits. So this line basically is kind of sort of as short as it can be for the moment. So let's take a look at the remaining pieces. Just by looking at that, I would say, so just to give some explanation, I have not really looked at the code in depth. I looked at it shortly and get some ideas, but I thought it would be worthwhile to take you with my thoughts while I'm looking at the code, and we will see together if and how we can refactor that. So that's why it might take a little bit longer than you might expect. But that's exactly what we do at work. We look at the code and try to make it as good as possible. And if it takes half an hour to make it good, then that's worthwhile because the next one trying to read the code will take more than half this hour to understand what actually is happening here if we don't do it right. So let's continue. The method is configuring a security context. All right. So here is actually start. I can actually start seeing something done with security context, and this seems to be the actual configuration. So just by taking a look, I can see at least 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 actions being made in this single method. So here is an header filter created. Here is another filter created, and that's a third filter created. And then there is a configuration for anonymous, and then there's a configuration for non-anonymous. So with five, and then there's this piece in the middle. But taking that out of the picture, because I think that's actually the only really real thing that belongs into this method, taking that out, we have at least 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bits that are too many, that don't belong into this method. At least not in their completeness. Because here we actually are constructing the header filter, and in the process of configuring the security context, We don't need to know how to configure the security filter at all. We just need a way to say, please configure me one filter, and that's enough. Like, all this code here is too much in this method. So we need to move it to a separate method. So I select all of this and refactor to a method, and he can't do that. Yeah, because I don't know. Let's just try to do it manually then. And call it create security header filter. That seems to be an okay-ish name. So go ahead and call it create header filter. And all of this configuration, like just judging from the eye, I can see that this is three times the same. But for the moment, let's just leave it alone and move it into this method. So we extract the variable here and we call it filter. And then we say, okay, please configure me this filter the way it is. And we can already see that we need some more input here, so extract that as a parameter. And then we can jump up to the caller, and IntelliJ already automatically injected the matching detail source here. So what we basically now worked out is that creating this filter requires this detail source. That was something that was buried in the code all the time. But if you look at the that was too much, just the class name. But if we look at the original code, let's take a look where this piece of code is created. It's not really at all visible where this detail source is used by if you do not read through the complete code. But now that we splitted out this method, it's easily visible that the parameter used here is the one created up here. So now we refactor that, but let's see if we can make the return value more abstract, because from the point of configuring the security context, we create a header filter. We do not really need to know what specific type of header filter that is. Any header filter will do, and the specific type should only be need to known inside this class, this generator method. So let's see how the abstraction, the inheritance chain is. So it extends abstract filter, which extends another abstract filter, which extends a generic filter, which implements filter. So maybe we can just go ahead and say filter here, filter there. That won't work because then the specific configuration here wouldn't be able to happen. But just return a filter here and say we need a filter here, and that's fine. So now my really long class name here is gone, and that means that within the configuration method, I don't need to care what filter that actually is. It's just a filter. It is there, and which kind of filter is now abstracted array in this creation method. And going on, we can do the exact same thing with the other things, with the other filters that are created here. So let's extract this into a method and call it create security token filter and move this configuration there. I don't know why IntelliJ keeps creating these annotations. Let's see if we can avoid that. Let's call it filter again to have some symmetry between the creation methods, which makes it a lot easier for someone who is just checking out the code to see what actually is repetitive and what's specific. So we also need this parameter here, and we can also specify the type because we know it. It's a detail source of this kind, and we can simplify the type here and do that one more time with this third filter and create gateway whatever filter, I don't know, and I don't need to care at all because I abstracted that away in these creation methods. So the main thing that we are doing is we are splitting responsibility. And we are splitting it the way that creating and configuring these filters is one thing to do. That's the thing that these methods do. And using it is another thing to do. Using it and plugging the things together is the task of this method. So by splitting this these responsibilities, we can make the individual methods more readable, because I can just take a look at here and only care about how this filter is constructed. And what's more important is I can read this method, which will become a lot shorter once we are done. And I can read it and understand it without needing to know the specifics of all these different filters. I just need to know that they are in existence and I need to use them, but their specific construction doesn't matter to the big picture. So that already looks a lot better. So what's next? Then we have these pieces here. This one is obviously configuring something for anonymous controller security. So let's extract that into a method and call it configure configure anonymous security. And this one is required to do non-anonymous. So maybe configure authenticated security. But now something really interesting happened. So all these filters are only used in this branch. So they aren't needed at all in this branch. So there is actually no reason to construct the filters up here. We could easily just pull them down to here and have them configured within the authentication security configurer method. So pull them here and remove them from the args. There's probably a really good refactoring option. And what we still need is the authentication source. So pull then that back to the parameter. And now the order of the arguments is wrong. So it's not identical between those two. That's a bad thing to do. So let's go to refactor signature change. Okay, and move that around the other way, and it updates all the usages. So now we have a nice authenticated security, configure authenticated and configure anonymous security. And also where we added, like maybe wrap this logging better so that it is actually readable and we can actually see what will probably be logged when we're finished. Maybe like that. That's okay. Okay. So now we can start to finally see what's actually happening. And have a look. So these blocks here, they are basically configuring the security context. And they need all these configuration items. But what I don't like is is that they are not symmetrical. So here's an add filter, there's an add filter, there's an add filter. So why are they not broken down into three lines? So I can actually see that all the filters are added here. And then it goes on with request matchers and matcher. So that's probably A thing for itself and anonymous disable. And then authorize requests, any requests authenticated. I find them hard to read. Like they try to be readable English, but you don't know really where the sentences end. So that's why I find the Spring Security code to be really hard to read. But just by rolling it out, it starts to get more readable. So here we have a lambda that takes. So just to, if you don't know what a lambda is, it's basically a construction of an anonymous inner class. So authentication entry point is the class that's required here, and it has a single method. And whenever you have a class that only has one method, or basically it's an interface probably or an abstract class, it's an interface. Whenever you have a single method interface, you can also represent that as a lambda. And that's basically the compiler is right here. You see like how IntelliJ can switch from one to the other, is creating a new instance of this interface, implements the method and puts your lambda within here. So lambdas are just a short way of creating those anonymous inner classes. But when writing lambdas, it's important to keep things together because they are if it would be a class, then you would have like this method entrance, which obviously states here is my code starting and here does it end. But when it is a lambda, it's so short that you don't really see which parts are arguments and which parts are actually code. So what I tend to do is just like either write it in a line if that's possible. So then you can see parameters action or move the complete action into its own line so you can see this is my action code. Okay. So that starts to look a lot better. Another thing that you can do is, at least in IntelliJ, is disable the formatter for these areas. Formatter off, the auto formatter. We do this a lot for rest assured tests. And then you can start, like, if there is logic in here, you can start to show that by indenting the pieces that belong together. But I don't really know if these calls kind of sort of have to do with these or if they are independent, so I would not go this route unless I really know what I'm doing and I don't. I'm just trying to rework the code. So, one thing that I don't like is this short node, shorting, I don't know, this shorted text. So your variables should not contain, or even your class files, that would be worse, should not contain abbreviations. So what does SEC mean? It might mean security, it might mean secondary, it might mean something completely different, just depending where you and your team start from. Just from the class, it probably means security, but it's only used in two places. It's used here and here. So why not make it HTTP security? It doesn't make your code any less readable. Actually, it avoids, if you take a look here, to have to look up the parameter and its type before you know what sec actually means. And I would probably do that for the other method as well. So while we are here, let's try to refactor that code a little bit too. So what are we actually seeing here? Like here is a filter created. These are constant arguments, and then here is a list added. A list with a single member. Okay, so what I would do, and IntelliJ already warns us that as list is with only one argument is problematic. So it suggests to use singleton list. I think the main difference is that singleton list is unmodifiable. It doesn't really say why here, but it says the returned list is serializable and provides a convenient way. Changes to the returned list right through to the array. So you give it an array and make a list out of it. So that's what array as list actually does. When I look at it, it actually says it takes a list. So in Java, variadic functions and lists are actually the same. So having a T bracket here is the same thing as having a variadic T here. But as list is basically meant to convert from the old style arrays to the new style lists. It's not meant to create an inline list, but people use it for that. And singleton list is meant for doing just that, like creating a list interface with just a single item in the most possible efficient way. So let's use singleton list here as suggested. So this is something that has nothing to do with the construction. For my eyes, this basically also does not have to do anything with the construction of the filter. So let's extract that into a method and call it anonymous authority, maybe. Anonymous authority. And let's check how the inner written chain is here. So the constructor takes a list of granted authority. And simple granted authority is a specific implementation of granted authority. So let's remove that specific part and just make it a granted authority. That way, when we're constructing this list, we do not have to know that simple granted authority is also a granted authority. We just documented that in the code that it doesn't matter. And also like that simple here is, it may be necessary when creating it, but in using it later, it shouldn't matter if it is simple or not. It's just an authority granted. So let's have that external, and then we construct the filter, set the details source, okay. And then we configure the HTTP security. So that's another example where I don't really like this long sentence-like style. Let's make that a line-by-line style. So request matcher, and matcher, and. Okay, so we can, like maybe that's what we should do, is move the ands into their own line. And maybe they actually show where additional sentences start. What about that? I think I like that. So now I can see that there is one thing happening and another thing and another thing and another thing. So now I see that there are four different things configured. Let's try that here in the anonymous part too. Disable the formatter here and turn it on again here. So HTTP key and matches. And just pull that one indent to the left. Like, you can format that any other way. It's something that as you get started, probably your team will remind you, hey, we formatted it the other way in this other file. Just do it the same, please. If you have pull requests and colleagues that check for that. So you will like start getting your own style. And I think we do with this half indent for sentences a lot in the rest assured call chains, which are equally long to these. So security context disable anonymous. Okay, and then authentication filter, anonymous filter. Yeah, that seems plausible to me, maybe. Okay, now let's take a look at what's happening here. So we have the remaining shorthand here. And what we see here is like that's basically meant to be a call chain. So that's meant to be just continued here. But this piece is optional, like require secure is only enabled if is required SSL is set. And what they did not want to do is repeat either this part for this part, and for this reason, they use a mutable security, immutable security field here. So, let's think about that. They are all mutating the HTTP security anyway, don't they? Like, if I call disable, let's take a look what's happening here. So, what we see here is the decompiled class file, but because this is all open source, I can just download the source files and have a look at the original source. So, disable get builder, remove configurer class, return get builder. So, to me, that looks like these calls are mutating the original object anyway. So, this HTTP instance is mutated by calling disable. Let's check that. Disable. So it changes get builder. It gets a builder, then changes it, and then gets another builder. So in order to have make to make any sense out of that, the builder returned here needs to be the same builder here. So they are mutating. Yeah, if there is none, throw a state exception, return the builder. Okay. So it would probably be possible to get rid of this variable altogether and just say, okay, HTTP CRSF. Disable and then requires channel any request secure, and then we can also skip the end because we take the original one and use that here directly. And we could rename that to HTTP security. That would probably be okay. So now we are here, we have hidden the mutability, and what's most important is we have hidden and removed this read and assign piece here, where we read, do something, the loose end at the end, and then do an assignment. That's usually what you do if you're not sure if something is mutating or returning a new instance. We can check what end actually does is this end, and it returns the builder in the end again. So I am quite sure that we can do it this way, and now these texts actually make sense and they are reorderable. So we can reorder them without changing the meaning, which we couldn't do before because there was a hard order given by the inherent by the assignment chain. So let's take a final look at what we're actually doing here. We could extract this out some more, but I don't really see a reason because it would be a method that just contains the new. We could abstract away the information that creating the source actually is just a new, and that if there at any time in the future would be some configuration to be done for the source, we could just create authentication detail source, which would be a really simple method. And if in any time in the future we needed some configuration, it would be clear that we could do that here. Is there any configuration? No, there isn't. But that would be something that I'm not sure if I would do that. Maybe for the sake of keeping things symmetrical. So, two things that I would like to talk about. One thing would be method order. Let's check the method order. And the other thing that I would like to talk about is testing for this class. So, let's talk about method ordering. So, usually we say that the methods should be ordered in the order that they are used. And most of the time, you have one entrance method, like probably. That would be this here, like check the structure. There is just one public method, everything else is private. So this is the only entrance method. And probably the first thing that someone would read when they start examining the class. So the following code should be ordered in the way that it needs to be read to understand the main entrance method. So first the create details source, that's okay. Then there is anonymous security. And here we have like the order reversed, like move the anonymous security to the top, and there's nothing else that we need here, and then the authenticated security. And then we need to take a look at the security token filter. That's the first one. And then security header, security token, it's the second one. And then the last thing we need is the gateway security token filter, and that's the last method. Oh, there's one more thing. We kind of skipped on this repetition. If you see such a true repetition, it's probably that these things all inherit the same class. And we already know that because we are like returning filter, or we could return filter from all of them. So let's check which class actually implements these methods. And it's abstract pre-authentication processing filter. What a class name. So let's take that name, and we could like extract this into its own method and call it configure. No, I don't like that name. It doesn't tell me anything. Configure filter, maybe. And if it's called configure filter, we could say that it needs to filter first. And also abstract pre-authentication processing filter, that's the one that all of these implement. And yeah, let's go with that, refactor. And now what we could do is use this method here in the same way. But just looking at it, I think that I would write this method. What? Why can't I do it like this? I can. I would not write this method as a void method, but as a chainable method and return the filter here. And this would allow us to do something like to shorten the code a little bit more and do configure filter here. And that would be something that we could copy and paste for all the other methods. That should work for all of them. And now we need to talk about the method order once more. Yeah, like if you follow my talk from before, you would say that the place is the right place because it is needed here. But for symmetry points, I would move it down because it's used from all of these creation methods. And just by looking at, I would probably think about extracting these methods into their own class because they're like the filter creation thing and do not have a lot to do with the HTTP configuration. I would probably extract these into their own class and have it auto-wired here. Just to make the class shorter, because we increased our length by 150 lines by splitting things up. Yeah, let's try to do that while we're at it. And create a controller security. Let's create a class controller filters, maybe like that. And start moving things. So we need all of these over there. And now we see that we need kind of most of these auto-wired imports, not all. Security properties is needed here, and DDI security properties is needed here. Okay, but the other ones, like that, usually they would be auto-wired, like auto-wired, like Spring would find some class that creates an instance of this and inject it into our class here. So that's like dependency injection. But because I'm just mocking around, I didn't bother to configure that correctly. So move them over here just so the compiler is happy, and we also need like the DDI security thingy. So, and we need a way to create the authentication manager. I skipped on this part too. So now we are basically, we have that extracted, and now let's make them, yeah, maybe they're public, maybe they're package private, I don't know. So what's your problem here? Won't you tell me? In a resolve method? Yeah. He found that the methods probably are the same because I moved them, and asks me how I would like to call them here, because we like shortened our code here to just use the method calls. It's now really simple to have our filter provider, just call it filters maybe, to have our filter provider here and ask it to create the filters that we need for us. So now this class is quite short again, and although it only has the authenticated security and the anonymous security part and the detail source, user detail source, and the decision and the basic configuration SSL and CSRF. So that's what basically belongs here. And then we have the filters, which are completely separated, which we didn't see before. Before that was all smeared into one method, intermixed with each other. So now that we basically have cleaned up our code into two quite readable classes, let's talk about testing. We need to talk about whether these methods are testable at all, and then we need to talk about whether we should test them. So are they testable? Yeah, but it's hard. So in order to test this method, you would need to mock all of these and this, and then that's it. So you would need to mock a lot of objects. And that's usually a sign that it's the wrong level of testing. So unit tests are not the way to test this kind of code. Another indicator is how much actual business code is in here. So if we, for example, take a look at this method, then here's no business code, which we just call one method. And here is no business code because we are configuring a third-party framework. And this third-party framework is hopefully already tested. So all of these methods, they are already tested. And the only thing that we could test here is if we configure the framework right. So similar here, yeah, here there are some decisions like if require SSL, if is enabled authentication, but also the other thing, but also here, the only thing that we could test at all at the unit test level is if we are using, if you are configuring the framework correctly. And that's usually not useful because your tests would basically be just a copy of this that checks that there are three filters added, there is the ARM matchers added, and there is anonymous disabled. And basically it would be just a copy and paste of this code. And you would have no way to check if you actually understood the security configuration that you wrote here. So that's the reason why I would not suggest unit tests here. Instead, I would argue and say, let's test it, maybe not end to end, but maybe at the HTTP level. It's HTTP security. So let's do an integration test where we launch the server and then send with a certain given configuration and then send requests to it and check that the things that we want it to accept are accepted, and the things that we do not want to accept are not accepted. Usually something like this is done with REST assured. I already mentioned that multiple times, which is a great REST test framework where you can, like, when I get this, then I expect, and something more. And these chains can be really complicated and you can easily post or put or do whatever calls you want with authentication without. So what I probably would do is have a set of IT tests that configures my server for different configurations, like for example with authentication, without, with SSL, without, and then have tests that ensure that the pieces that I do not want it to have are not allowed. Like for example, I can't do an anonymous request when I disabled anonymous requests. And then I would like test all of this code completely, and also I would test that I have understood the framework that I'm configuring. And maybe not missed something or added something that doesn't belong here. And for something like security configuration, I would really go to town on this level and say, like, I want to test with an invalid user, with an old user, with a non-existing user, without a user, and ensure with and without SSL, with and without course headers, or no, not course, what's the thing, CSIF headers, and really go to town on this level and ensure that my security configuration is correct, because Spring security configuration is really a complicated thing and you can do a lot wrong just by configuring it wrong. So that's something where REST tests would shine, and they would be much more easy to write than unit tests and much more straightforward because they are in the terminology that you actually use. You talk about CSIF, you talk about authentication, and you can keep on talking with these words to your REST test framework. So I would suggest doing REST tests for these pieces of configuration for all the variables that you want. But if you do not want those variables, just get rid of them. And if you do not want to be able to run your code without SSL, just remove it and this option and have it require SSL always, or just remove the anonymous part and don't leave it in there, because it is security related code and every code path that is here that we don't want to be in our production system, then we should remove it. Yeah, it's a possible attack vector and a misconfiguration vector too. So now I have waffled on about like nearly an hour about a simple snippet of maybe 50 lines, but 50 lines of code are as equal important than like 100 or 200 lines. And just because it's not a lot, it doesn't mean that you should not think about it, because it is important code, it's security related code. And the next one who is going to read it, like my friend, took a look at it and said, I don't understand what's going on here because it is unreadable. And he's right. I don't understand what's going on here either. But when we take a look at what we have now, then the things suddenly have names and are identifiable, and you can talk about them and remove them if you don't need them. And like by just seeing, okay, that's used here, let's disable that for a moment. And it's much more readable now. And it's important to think about your code quality. And it took us like an hour to refactor these 50 lines. But if you do that over and over again, the next time you write the code, you already see these patterns. You see that the original author already identified four different blocks here. And did we miss the download filter? I think we missed that. Yeah, okay. So that's something that's in their code and not in the example code, but doesn't matter. The original author already identified these blocks, but he didn't went the way to wrap them in methods and remove the specificalities from the main configure methods, so like taking filter here and extracting the specific configuration out of here. They already knew that these are four blocks. You can clearly see that they added empty lines in between. So the next time you are writing empty lines in your code to separate pieces and chunks of your code away, Think about if they would not probably be better methods that have a name, because that's the main thing that's missing here is like labels, names. And like splitting responsibility. So as you get used to doing these refactor tasks, you will learn to create better code from the start, and you don't need to refactor that much. And we usually learn that by doing source code reviews. And when someone is new to the team, then they will get 100 or more comments to their pull request because they need to refactor their code. And they learn it the way. And the next time they maybe only have like 20 remarks because they already knew, okay, if I do it this way, then they will ask me to refactor that. So go ahead, take a look at your code and see what you can refactor in your code. And try to create beautiful code if you can, because it makes the world better. So thank you very much. And if that was useful or in any way interesting for you, then just give me a thumbs up or give me a comment. And yeah, maybe I'll read and answer them. Bye bye.